Such a great song, Ian Dury and the Blockheads and Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll. That is the title also of a brand new film about the life of Ian Dury, and starring in the film and turning in a magnificent performance is Andy Serkis. Hello, sir.
Hello.
How are you?
Oh, fantastic, actually. It's been a right old hard day, but, you know, getting excited about the release tonight. So,
I can imagine. Andy, the film is Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll, and we were just talking there. You were a big fan of Ian Dury's music.
Yeah, absolutely. When I was 14, I remember hearing him on a radio going on a camping trip with his school, and it was just like suddenly this man kind of singing about, you know, hitting someone with a rhythm stick. It was just like, you know, this kind of bandsaw cutting through everything. And I'd grown up with three elder sisters who were listening to, you know, America and Bread and you know, Neil Young, and suddenly here we are with the, you know,
it's, I mean, I remember being a bit younger, but it being on Top of the Pops for the first time and just never having heard anything like it.
I think he
holds such a special, he might not be the biggest household name in the world, but
no.
For the people who love him, I think really love him.
But actually, surprisingly, he did touch a loads of people's lives. I mean, he's a national treasure.
Of course, he absolutely is
a national treasure, and one that deserves to have his story told. And when we started thinking about making the film, we were always really surprised that it hadn't been done, because I think now's the right time. As I say, it's 10 years on this year since he died, and he really did leave an incredible legacy of wonderful, you know, powerfully kind of written songs and great lyrics and challenging lyrics. And I mean, you know, he was around at a time when it was do-it-yourself music. It wasn't X Factor. It wasn't all laid on a plate and, you know, three judges, celebrity judges, telling you what to do or think. It was getting out there. And I mean, he was 10 years old to be a rock star. 10 years older.
Too old
a rock star.
I noticed from your regular speaking voice that, if not a full octave, but you're probably half an octave higher than the voice you use for Ian Dury in the film.
I kind of tried to push it down a bit, but actually in terms of singing, where we've got quite we have got quite a similar range, a timbre.
So how did you get his speaking voice? Did you smoke heavily for 6 months?
I did smoke quite a lot during the actual film, but I sort of just was conscious of using the lower bass tones, you know, just pushing down a bit.
How low can you go?
Down there.
I also, one thing I loved about it is, I mean, he's obviously, from his music, he's got this love of wordplay.
Yeah.
And in the film, you go off on these little flights of fantasy where you're playing with words, which is obviously something he did when he was songwriting.
Absolutely.
And I wondered, if was that scripted or was that something that you were improvising?
Yeah, no, that was absolutely scripted by our brilliant writer Paul Virag, who's this is his debut screenplay feature film, and he and I are really old friends, and we've been working together on projects for years, and this is the biggest one to date. And Paul is an extraordinary writer, and he absolutely researched it thoroughly, and we got involved and got to know Ian's family very well. And I mean, the main thrust of the story is about Ian's relationship with his son Baxter, as you well know, you saw the film earlier, but it's got an emotion, that's the emotional heartbeat of the film, and it is about creativity and a kind of creative obsession and madness and that kind of maelstrom world, but trying to juggle all the plates and keep the people around you who you love together. And Ian never wanted to sort of be alone. He hated being alone. He liked company, and he wanted to hold on to everybody. And that was a real strain. But actually, you know, that's the schism and the contradiction in the film, really.
One thing I was interested to ask you as an actor is, watching the film, I mean, we like our rock stars to be complicated. If you look at any number of rock stars, they're complicated individuals, and the art is, we very easily separate it from the artist. We accept that a lot of artists and rock stars are complicated people. But as an actor, how do you portray somebody as complicated as Ian Dury, but make them likable throughout?
Well, you know, I met Ian, and he was very difficult when I met him, and it was not a good meeting, and he was quite, you know, he was tough and had that capability of being really vitriolic and nasty, and then at the flip of a sixpence, he could be, you know, really charming and very, I mean, just always charismatic and always electric and mesmerising. I think mainly, what people responded to him to Ian was that he lived life to the full and in a very sort of uncompromising way. And so even if he was being challenging, it was you felt like he was doing it for, or he made people feel like he was doing it for their good. You know, so I think there's something of that in the characterization that we've chosen.
So when did you meet him?
I met him about 10 or 12 years ago. I went up to Leicester. I was doing a workshop for for a play that a director called Max Stafford Clarke was doing, based on a Sue Townsend book. He wrote Adrian Mulch.
She
wrote a book called The Queen and I, about the Queen being rehoused on a council estate in Leicester, and Ian was writing the music for it. And he met him in a Chinese restaurant, and it all kind of kicked off, and he was quite drunk. And it just all got a bit nasty, you know. So I was under no illusion when I took, you know, when we started working on the project, that and actually there that his family bore it out when we first showed them early drafts of the script. They went, he's much, much harder than that. He's much, much more nasty.
Usually you get the family trying to make him nicer.
No, they were like, come on, you've got to get down and dirty with this one. You know, he's tricky. And so once they came, you know, once they allowed us to go down that route, it made it easier.
Andy, as somebody, you're known a lot as a physical actor through the parts you've done as King Kong and Gollum. Is it difficult getting people to see you about parts which aren't to do with physical and CGI?
No, not really, because I mean those were sort of aberrations in my career, really. Big ones, having said that. Yeah. Because over the last 10 years since we started, I mean, it's 10 years since we started filming Lord of the Rings. Actually, I've played loads of other characters which aren't CG. I suppose those are the biggest and most well known because of the profile that the projects are.
But you like to take on a legend, though. We've had Gollum, King Kong, Ian Dury, Captain Haddock in Tintin is next.
Albert Einstein. 2 years ago.
Yes, of course, in the BBC thing. Yes, yeah. Have you got a voice for Captain Haddock yet?
Yeah, I can't tell you.
Go on, do a little bit.
Secrecy. I'll get sued. I'll get put in prison, and that'll be the end of it.
How often in a week do you get asked to do the Gollum voice?
About 32 times.
Because you used to love doing it, even when you were doing red carpet stuff, not for Lord of the Rings, you would happily do that voice.
No, I still don't mind.
Gives a little bit. Gives a little bit.
Oh, no! Please don't make me do it. God, you know you want to. I don't. I've had enough. Please, do it!
Annabelle, you look terrified. Annabelle's never seen Gollum.
Are you just wondering why I suddenly went into that?
No, I'm aware that you're in this film, but I only watched the first bit. I don't think you're in that bit. You're on The Hobbit.
The first bit?
She liked the bit where they're all happy in a village, but she didn't really like it when it got dark.
Were you in the first bit?
Oh, I was in the first bit, But it was only in the first bit of the first bit. Oh,
okay. Are you going to do The Hobbit? You're going to do the...
That's the plan. I mean, Guillermo del Toro's down in New Zealand preparing and with Peter Jackson and all the writers. So at some point this year, I expect it's all going to kick off. Yeah.
Fantastic. And there's a little nod to Lord of the Rings even in the Ian Dury film, isn't there, with the swimming pool? Just the slightest of nod about something dark lurking
in the pool evil lurks.
Yes,
absolutely.
It's a great cast you've got in there. In my notes,
amazing.
Somewhat depressingly, in my notes it mentions Ray Winstone and then in brackets father of Jamie Winstone, just in case. Which sort of a sudden made
I'm
me feel
sure
old.
Ray would be absolutely happy with that.
Of course.
Yeah.
And you've got Olivia Williams, who's in one of the greatest films of all time, Rushmore.
Yeah.
And also Naomi Harris, who's very, very good.
Honestly, those guys are just amazing, all of them.
Who did you like best out of the two of them?
It's a really politic question, isn't it? They're both fantastic. They're all, everyone. And Toby Jones came in. I mean, everyone was there. Mackenzie Crook turned in brilliant performance. Mm. Ralph Ineson. It's just like they were all there because they were really inspired by Ian and his music and wanted to be on board the project because it was a low budget film and you know that's what I mean. Ian's kind of legacy really does, you know, still resonates,
right? And it's really full and colourful. It's full of animation and there's a touch of the Moulin Rouge about it almost as well. The direction is lovely.
Well, Ian was really kind of influenced by music hall and he was taught by Peter Blake at Art College, so there's a real pop art feel to the whole film and the way it's presented and the way that we didn't want it to be the bog standard, you know. Ian was born in 1942 and he died in 2000. You know, it was like we're going to kick off and make it feel like a Blockheads gig and make it look visually like the energy of Ian, really, I suppose.